Welcome. This is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and this is Exploration. Every week in Exploration, we discuss the fascinating world of science and its impact on our lives. And today, we're going to take stock of the coronavirus. What have we learned in the last several months? You know, it's hard to believe that just 2 months or so ago, we had this international lockdown, and all of a sudden, our lives were turned upside down. The economy crashed. Unemployment skyrocketed. Civilization as we know it came to a halt. And the question is, what have we learned from this enormous tragedy? You know, epidemiologists predicted that there could be yet another wave, a second wave, a third wave, because of the fact that, well, sometimes people forget and they put their guard down. For example, just a few weeks ago, we had Memorial Day celebrations across the United States. And sure enough, 2 weeks later, we see a spike in admissions to hospitals, emergency care units, because of the fact that there was unnecessary crowding, yelling, screaming at the rallies, and maybe some of you may have participated in the historic anti-racist demonstrations around the country. And yes, epidemiologists are saying, brace yourself, we could see a spike in coronavirus admissions. So the question that we're going to ask today is, what have we learned from all this chaos? Well, first of all, we have to appreciate the fact that, well, pandemics in some sense are a price we pay for civilization. You see, where do these viruses come from anyway? About 60% of all diseases, roughly speaking, come from the animal kingdom. And that is, some of them are ancient diseases that infect animals since time immemorial. We, on the other hand, begin to emerge into their territory. We trespass on their breeding grounds, and some of these viruses hop over, mutate, and infect humans. So you see, in some weird sense, pandemics are the price we pay for civilization. When we were nomads in bands of just a few hundred people scavenging for whatever food we could find in the forest, then there was no such thing as epidemics. We lived in a steady state with the animal kingdom. But you see, once we began to expand into the areas that were inhabited by these ancient diseases, some of them began to hop over, especially with the creation of the cities. With the harnessing of agriculture 10,000 years ago, cities for the first time began to spring up, crowding became the norm. And of course, crowding means that you can spread viruses much more rapidly. Eventually, these cities turned into empires. And with the coming of empires, we had soldiers bringing back not just loot from overseas conquest, but also viruses and diseases from faraway lands. And also, shipping became a route of transmission for these diseases. For example, you can actually trace the spread of the Black Plague by looking at trading routes between Asia, the Middle East, and Europe. And today, of course, we have the jet airplane. In fact, by using computers and tracing the routes that airplanes took from China to the Middle East, to Europe, to the United States, you can actually see almost day by day how the coronavirus spread at the speed of a jet aircraft. So again, in some sense, these pandemics are the price we pay for civilization. So then the question we're going to ask today is, what have we learned from all of this? Given the fact that all 50 states are now emerging out of the cocoon of the mandatory lockdown, and sure enough, new spikes are beginning to emerge in at least 20 states across the U.S., sometimes spread by Memorial Day celebrations. Remember back in February, we had the Mardi Gras celebration in New Orleans. And some people thought that, well, maybe that's not such a good idea having hundreds of thousands of people congregate in just one tiny city, because that could spread the virus. And sure enough, 2 weeks after that, we saw the spread of the virus. And so then the question is, what have we learned about the spread of the symptoms of the virus? First of all, we now have a timeline from exposure to infection to being on the ventilator to perhaps even death. We have a timeline of how the virus spreads. First of all, when you are infected by the virus, the first symptoms emerge on average 5 days after the infection takes place, sometimes as late as 2 weeks. But on average, 5 days after the infection, the first symptoms begin to emerge. However, we should point out that 50% of those people, up to 50% of those people, are asymptomatic. And you may not even know that you have been exposed to the virus. So in other words, 5 days after you've been exposed to the virus, you come down with symptoms. And the evolution of the symptoms is quite dramatic. We once thought we knew what the symptoms were: fever, dry cough, difficulty breathing. But now we have a whole slew of other symptoms that have emerged: pink eye, diarrhea, headaches, body aches, loss of smell and taste, chills. And so we realize that we're just learning about how widespread and how dangerous this virus really is. Now, there's some good news and bad news with respect to this. The good news is, for the most part, if you're young and you're healthy and you have no underlying medical conditions, chances are you're not going to come down with the virus. And the fatality rate for those who do come down with the virus is just about 1%. Now, that in turn is 10 times higher than the fatality rate of the flu virus. But again, it's not 90%. It's just 1% of those people that are infected will come down with the virus. So in other words, most people will actually go through it, and some of them may not even know it. However, if you are in a targeted population that's most vulnerable, for example, the elderly, people with underlying conditions like heart disease, diabetes, obesity, then watch out. And we also now know that the spread of the virus is much more widespread than we previously thought. For example, we now know that when you simply talk to somebody, you spread about 1,000 particles of droplets of water in the air per minute. So when you talk to somebody, there's a certain probability that you could come down with the coronavirus. And if you're sitting next to someone who's yelling or singing, that number goes up to 10,000. 10,000 droplets that are emanating from the person's mouth. Now, this explains certain unusual features of this virus. There are some people called super spreaders. People that, innocently enough, went to a bridge game and then infected the entire bridge club. Or choirs, church choirs, where singing, of course, is the norm, we see that the coronavirus spreads very rapidly in church choirs. And so we begin to realize that the virus spreads much more rapidly than the flu virus. So there are new guidelines being set. Now, these guidelines are not yet official, but this is what you see in the scientific literature. First, avoid closed rooms. That is, rooms where there's no circulation of the air, because, as I mentioned, one super spreader can infect hundreds of other people simply by being in close quarters, in a bridge game, a church choir. Also, when possible, avoid people who are speaking loudly, because by speaking loudly, you can increase the number of droplets that spread in the air by a factor of 10. Avoid singing, chanting, loud shouting, if possible. Also, if you are talking to somebody, keep it short. The longer you talk to someone who's infected, the larger the viral load you inhale, and the greater the chances that you could come down with the virus. So if you have to talk to people, keep it short. And also, wear a mask. This is not foolproof, but we now realize that it does afford a considerable amount of protection against the virus. For example, in Asia, like Japan, for example, wearing masks is the norm, especially if you have a cold. And so some people think that's one reason why the Japanese population has not been affected as severely as in other populations. So also, safe distancing, 6 feet is the recommended distance, but some people are saying that the virus can spread much faster and farther than previously thought. Once the virus is aerosolized, it can spread up to 20 feet, not just 6 feet. So 6 feet is a good distance on average to separate individuals. But just realize that you can infect somebody over a distance of perhaps 20 feet, especially if they're not wearing a mask or they're speaking too loud and they're spewing virus particles into the air. Now, the other thing is, what should you do then if you think you have the disease? Let's say you were at a Memorial Day celebration. Let's say you were at an anti-racist demonstration and you start to come down with a dry cough, chest pains. What should you do? Well, as I said before, 5 days after the exposure to the virus, you can come down on average with symptoms. And then it takes several more days for people to realize that they're really sick. And maybe a week later, they talk to the doctor and they get admitted to the hospital. And then something happens that's rather unexpected. And that is, by the time you go to the hospital, the symptoms are quite severe, and usually you don't survive. In a worst case, you get put in an ICU. However, if you are on a ventilator, 90%, up to 90% of the people on a ventilator never make it. So in other words, people wait too long. They can speak to their friends. They can speak on the telephone. They think that they are gonna gut it out. And however, by the time it's severe enough for them to call for the hospital, call for the ambulance, it's too late. They go to the hospital and they die. And scientists were wondering why. Why is it that for a long period of time, people can talk on the telephone, act normal, then they go to the hospital and they die? Well, the answer to this is found in the oxygen level of the blood. It turns out that after exposure, you could be dropping your oxygen content in your blood, but you compensate. You compensate for this by breathing faster, breathing deeper, so you can still talk on the telephone, and you say to yourself, I'm going to gut it out. I don't have to go to the hospital. But meanwhile, your body's being starved of oxygen. So by the time you go to the hospital, it's too late. You're already on the late stages of the disease, and sad to say, many die. So what can you do? One thing you could do is buy an oximeter. O-X-I-M-E-T-E-R. An oximeter is an oxygen meter. It's a very simple device. You simply stick it on your finger. Doesn't prick your finger at all. It simply shines ultraviolet radiation through your finger to measure the color of your blood. When your blood, for example, is rich in oxygen, it's reddish. When it's depleted of oxygen, it turns slightly bluish. And so with an infrared sensor, you can very easily calculate the oxygenation of your blood to tell you that you are dying for lack of oxygen, even though you don't feel it. It's an early warning system that tells you that you are dying, even if you don't feel like you are dying. So an oximeter reading of between 95 to 100 is normal. However, once it starts to drop below 95, then watch out. That's the time to call for a hospital, for an ambulance. That's the time to call for your doctor. That means you're being deprived of oxygen. Many scientists and doctors were shocked to find that by the time you wind up in a hospital, some patients had an oximeter reading of 50. 50%. They were dying. They were on their deathbed, but they didn't realize it because they would simply breathe deeper, faster, and compensate for the fact that their bodies were starved of oxygen. And it turns out that oximeters are sold in pharmacies. You can buy them online. They only cost about $50. And it's an early warning system, that tells you that your body is starved of oxygen, even though you don't necessarily feel like you're dying. Also, there's some good news on the horizon, and that is the march to create a vaccine for the coronavirus is moving much faster than previously thought. When it was first announced that there would be an Operation Warp Speed to get a vaccine off the ground by the end of the year or early next year, some scientists began to snicker and laugh and say, now, wait a minute, we've never done that before, especially with the coronavirus. We've never been able to market a successful vaccine within a matter of just a few years. And here's the goal, to have a vaccine for billions, of people. Well, what's the bottleneck? The bottleneck is that you have to go through three phases, phase one, two, three, in order to make sure that the vaccine is effective and that it has no side effects. In phase one, you basically test your vaccine on a handful of people, tens of people in phase one trials. Phase two trials, you then graduate to several hundred individuals are being given the vaccine. And phase three trials, you now begin to inoculate tens of thousands of people. For example, you would inoculate 30,000 people, 20,000 were given the vaccine, and 10,000 were given the placebo. And then after phase three trials, then you can begin to mass produce the vaccine for literally millions of people. Well, believe it or not, we're now entering not phase one, not phase two, but phase three trials. Now, how is it possible to compress many years of testing into just a few months? And, well, there's several reasons. One is money. Hundreds of millions and billions are being thrown at these companies like Johnson & Johnson and Pfizer and Moderna to create the vaccine. Second, about 100, over 100 test vaccines are now being experimented with around the world. It's good to have redundancy. Many of these trial vaccines will not make the grade. Some will. And that's why you want to hedge your bets. And at the present time, more than 100 possible vaccines are being looked at very seriously. And also, these phases are being compressed. That is, doctors are doing these tests simultaneously. And so phase one, phase two, phase three trials are taking place at the same time. So where are we? Believe it or not, in the next few weeks, in July, we will enter phase three trials. This is incredible. Many people thought that we wouldn't be at this stage for another year. And here we are already entering phase three trials in July. So here is a possible timeline. In July, tens of thousands of individuals will be given the vaccine and monitored very carefully. Then perhaps around September, the vaccine will be given to doctors and nurses and emergency crew people, people that are on the front lines of our defense. That's going to take place perhaps in September. And then perhaps starting in January, we're talking about mass inoculations of hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of people. The first people, as I mentioned, will be the people on the front line. The second stage could be, for example, people who are most vulnerable. That is, the elderly, people over 65, people with underlying conditions, people that have problems with diabetes and obesity and with high blood pressure. So that's another possibility. And then billions of doses of these vaccines are going to be created. We're not talking about tens of thousands, but we're talking about billions of doses that are going to be available. And to speed it up even faster, tens of thousands of people around the world have volunteered to be injected directly with the coronavirus. This is amazing. And of course, these people have no underlying medical conditions. They're young, they're healthy, but they are volunteering. They're volunteering to be deliberately injected with a disease which has already killed hundreds of thousands of people around the world. And yes, that will also accelerate the process by which we can immunize the population of the world. Now, of course, something could go wrong. What could go wrong? Well, first of all, perhaps the effect of the vaccine does not last more than a few months, or perhaps just a season. In which case, like the flu shot, we may have to have it every year. That's not known. We just don't know how effective these vaccines are going to be. And second of all, most concerning, is the possibility of side effects. Many doctors remember the collapse of the drug thalidomide. Thalidomide was once heralded as some kind of miracle sleeping pill. However, as the months went by, women gave birth to children that were horribly born defective. They had no arms or no legs, and they were the thalidomide babies. And that was a wake-up call. The wake-up call is, of course, you have to be very serious about side effects, especially for pregnant women. And that meant that the clinical trials had to be upgraded after that, the collapse of testing for the drug thalidomide. And then the next question is the future. What are we going to do about the future, given the fact that our very lifestyle is going to be turned upside down? Well, some people are saying that we can learn the lessons of South Korea and Taiwan. Those are countries that were able to manage the virus without necessarily disrupting their entire economy. And the reason why countries like South Korea and Taiwan were so successful is because they had a trial run. They had the SARS scare in the last decade, and they had experience. So as soon as they heard word that there was this mystery virus emerging from China, immediately they went into a partial lockdown. Immediately they went into contact tracing. Immediately they begin to use high technology to monitor the spread of the disease. So in the future, we may simply have to live with this new kind of normal. For example, when you go to the airport, today you simply check in your bags and have an x-ray. It's a nuisance, but everyone realized that it's for the better. So in the future, when you go on an airplane, you may have a rapid test of the virus right on the spot, and in just 5-10 minutes, you'll know whether or not you should get on that airplane. And so this could be simply a way of life. We may have to realize that there could be a new normal in the way we interact with other people. And that's the price we pay for civilization. Another possibility is to use artificial intelligence and high technology to create an early warning system, alerting us of the possibility of a hotspot being created right before our eyes in real time. For example, the Kinsa company markets thermometers, which are connected to the internet. And so by scanning the entire United States, you can see where hotspots are emerging, where fevers are above normal. For example, during the Mardi Gras celebration of February, you can actually see, going back through the data, the fact that it was a spike in fevers in the New Orleans area. And if the alert went out, the lives of perhaps thousands of people could have been saved by alerting them to the fact that, yes, there's a hotspot, get ready, get your hospital crews ready, brace yourself for another epidemic right in your own backyard. So high technology gives us the possibility of looking for anomalies, strange disturbances in the ether sphere, which can be spotted by artificial intelligence, alerting us to the fact that maybe, just maybe, there's a new hotspot emerging right before our eyes. And of course, this has to be done consistent with preserving privacy. We want to make sure that this does not infringe upon people's right to privacy. However, it does mean that by looking at scores of data around the country, around the world, we can be alerted to the fact that anonymously, something is happening. Something is happening in cyberspace, indicating that there could be a new spike in fevers, hospitalizations, emergency crews, a new spike, and we'll be prepared for another pandemic before it emerges. And lastly, we should point out that even if all vaccines fail, even if it turns out that we wasted billions of dollars trying to create a vaccine, there's still some hope. Think of HIV. There's no vaccine against HIV because it mutates too rapidly. But scientists have been able to look at the reproductive cycle of the HIV virus to find three weak spots. And by using three different drugs to target these three different weak spots in the reproduction cycle of the virus, it was possible to hold the HIV virus at bay. So even though there's no cure against HIV, it means that we can live with it using therapeutics. And so one possibility is that we use the advanced techniques of biotechnology and genomics to isolate the weak spots in the reproduction cycle of the coronavirus and create a cocktail of drugs to target each of these three weak spots. So there's still hope, even if a vaccine does not materialize. Well, I'm afraid that concludes the first part of Exploration. Stay tuned now for the second half of Exploration when we continue a discussion of science, the science of genetics. The science of genetics of the human race. We can now trace the lineage of humanity going back literally hundreds of thousands of years into the past. So stay with us for the second half of Exploration when we talk about the genealogy of, well, the coronavirus and also the human race. Welcome. Once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College at the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and this is the second half of Exploration. In the first half of Exploration, we took stock of where we are with respect to the coronavirus. Now, one thing we should emphasize is that we have genetically sequenced the lineage, the genetic lineage of the coronavirus. We can trace how it mutated. We can trace how it originated from Wuhan, China, spread to Europe, and then from Europe to the United States. And all of this is because we have genetic technology from the Human Genome Project, which has allowed us to trace not just the genetic lineage of the coronavirus, but also humanity itself. You know, when I was a kid in elementary school, we wondered about where peoples came from. Where did the Native Americans come from? Where did the Polynesians come from in the middle of the Pacific Ocean? They were mysteries that seemed to be forever beyond the realm of science. But now with genetics, we can actually trace the genetic lineage of many Native Americans. We now know that there have been at least three, maybe more, migrations from Asia, in particular Mongolia, into the so-called New World to populate the Americas, creating the Native American population. And we now know that the Polynesians, not all of them, but many of them originated from Taiwan. And so a lot of the mysteries of old are now being answered using our own blood, that this information is contained in our own cells. And by analyzing the genetics at the rate of mutation of our cells, we can actually trace the lineage of the human race itself. So with us today in the second half of exploration is Spencer Wells of National Geographic, who will talk to us today about the origins of the human race.
The first question for you is, how did you first get interested as a youth in the whole question of biology?
Well, it came about kind of secondarily. When I was very young, kind of 6, 7, 8 years old, beginning to think about how I'd want to spend the rest of my life, you know, to the extent that you can at that age, I was fascinated by history, by the idea of traveling back in time. I went to see the King Tut exhibit that toured the States in the late 70s. And I was absolutely fascinated by the idea that, you know, there was a culture that existed thousands of years ago, and they made these amazing things. So it was, you know, from a historical background that I was interested in, you know, investigating the world and all of that. And around that time, my mother actually went back to school to get her PhD in biology. And I started hanging out in the laboratory with her, and I discovered that science, while, you know, it is kind of odd in some ways, it's not really about, you know, secretive people speaking a special language, wearing white coats. It's really about discovering new things. It's about creating novelty. And every day is like solving a puzzle. And that is an incredible thing to be able to do. And so, you know, I started off with this interest in history, but it kind of morphed into a love of what you can do with science, investigating the world and discovering new things. And ultimately, by the time I was in high school, I decided that I wanted to use science as a tool for investigating the past, and that's what I've ended up doing, so I'm very lucky.
And how did you get interested in the whole aspect of using genes to trace human genealogy going back thousands of years?
Well, if you are scientifically minded and you want to be a scientist, there's a lot of mechanistic stuff that you need to learn. You need to learn how atoms combine into molecules in organic chemistry, and you need to learn how genes are turned on and off and all of that stuff. But again, what I wanted to do ultimately was to use the knowledge of biology, use molecular biology as a tool to investigate the past. And so as a biologist, that means that you're studying evolution. You're studying the biological history of a species. And I did my PhD work with a guy called Dick Lewontin, a very famous genetics professor at Harvard, working on fruit fly evolution. And you find out, if you investigate the way genes change over time, the way evolution actually occurs at a mechanistic level, that so much of evolution has to do with population history, the history of how individuals and populations have moved around and mated with each other. And that's just not inherently interesting for fruit flies, at least for me. Mm-hmm. But it is when you kind of map it onto human history and you start thinking about human migrations and human origins. And that's where I really made the switch. I started using these techniques that we had developed over many years for studying species evolution and used them, wanted to apply that to studying questions of human history and, you know, where did we originate as a species? How did we move around the planet? How did we get to Tierra del Fuego in Iceland and places like that? So using the tools of genetics to study the past.
Now, last year we had Professor Sykes on the radio show. He traced the lineage through the female genome, looking at the genes within the mitochondria of the cell. And he even dubbed certain names. Laura, for example, was mm-hmm. the woman whose children, believe it or not, or whose genes have spread to all Europeans and Asians. And he gave a rather graphic account of how you can trace the genes through the female line. Now, you've done a lot of work on the Y chromosome. So tell us a little bit about what is the Y chromosome and why is the Y chromosome so crucial in terms of unlocking the genealogy of human evolution?
Well, if you can trace back in time through the female line to find an Eve, it begs the question of, was there an Adam around at the same time? is there a tool that you can use to study the male line of descent? And it turns out, yes, there is, and it's what we call the Y chromosome. Now, sex in mammals is determined by the sex chromosomes, and if you have mismatched sex chromosomes, an X and a Y chromosome in this case, you are a male. If you have two X's, you're a female. So this is a chromosome which doesn't actually do very much other than to make men men. But because it is mismatched with its partner, the X chromosome, it doesn't go through the recombinational shuffling that occurs in most of the genome every generation, something that mixes up the genetic variation and creates new combinations, which is probably a good thing evolutionarily, which is the reason we have it. But it makes our lives very, very difficult. So for studying migration patterns, human origins, and so on, we ideally want a piece of DNA that isn't shuffled because it mixes up this variation, makes it very difficult to follow the order of events, if you will, going back in time. So we tend to study these non-recombining pieces of DNA, and Professor Sykes talked about the mitochondrial DNA tracing this female line, and we have studied the male line, the Y chromosome, which again does not recombine. It turns out that it is a fantastic tool for studying human migration patterns. For lots of reasons. The main reason is human mating patterns in most indigenous groups over time follow a particular rule, which is that the men really determine group membership, and therefore their Y chromosomes tend to stay put. Oddly enough, in most indigenous populations, the women tend to move around more than the men. And so the signal, the genetic signal that distinguishes between populations, tends to get blurred much more rapidly for the female line. That makes the Y chromosome a much better tool for studying differences between populations and therefore the migratory routes that we followed. So in trying to find this kind of atom lineage, it turned out that we also identified a tool which is fantastic for following migratory routes, which is what we want to be able to do, to reconstruct these journeys we've taken around the world.
So if you are a man, it means you have the Y chromosome of your father, your grandfather, your great-grandfather, but mutations occur along if you go back far enough. And I guess by tracing the sequence of mutations, you can then trace the family tree, right?
That's right. That's right. DNA is a very, very long molecule, and although our cellular machinery is very good at copying it when we have children, occasionally we make a mistake, a little spelling error, a single letter change, typically, in the DNA sequence, and when those changes are passed on, they create a line of descent. If you share a change with someone, you must share an ancestor at some point in the past. And so it's these changes that have accumulated over time that we use as the tools for studying the past with DNA.
Okay, now let's go back chronologically concerning the evolution of modern humans and migration patterns. Many anthropologists believe that about 100,000 years ago, you know, plus or minus tens of thousands of years, but about 100,000 years ago, modern humans who look pretty much like us, you give them a haircut, a three-piece suit, and put them on Wall Street, and they look like pretty much all the other barbarians on Wall Street. So let's say you now trace the lineage, because at that point, an out-of-Africa thing happened. Migrations took place out of Africa of modern humans. So now trace for us what happens 100,000 years ago as humans began to leave Africa.
Well, the history of migration out of Africa is actually much more complicated than that. You've got to distinguish, in this case, between anatomically modern humans, people who look pretty much like us, and people who act like us, people who are behaviorally modern. And given that our species is kind of created by our brains, we are Homo sapiens, wise man, it's really the behaviorally modern humans that we're interested in. So at 100,000 years ago, you're absolutely right. There are individuals in Africa and shortly thereafter just outside of Africa in the Middle East who look pretty much like us, but they're not acting like us. They haven't gone through the change in behavior which led to something we call the Upper Paleolithic in archaeology, a change in the way we interacted with the world, the creation of art, probably fully modern language like we're speaking now, syntactic language, change in group structure, and so on. That's when we really became modern humans. And so that exodus didn't actually occur until around 50,000 to 60,000 years ago, we think, from looking at the genetic data. Now, the people who are around at 100,000 years ago, as you said, yes, they did start to leave Africa. They made it into the Middle East, in fact. But after 80,000 years ago, they retreated back into Africa or went extinct. They didn't continue to exist outside of Africa. And in fact, at those sites in the Middle East that they made these initial forays out of Africa into, they were replaced by Neanderthals. And so they're pulling back into Africa after 80,000 years ago, and it's not until after 60,000 years ago that we get the real onslaught of modern humans with this modern human behavior.
Okay, so let's start now at 50,000 years, where humans that behave like us begin to migrate, and then a great diaspora begins to take place. So start to trace for us some of the markers as we trace the lineage of humans.
Well, so around 50 to 60,000 years ago, there was very likely an early migration along the southern coast of Asia. We can trace a lineage defined by a marker we call M130 or RPS4YT. You can call it the coastal marker, though, if you will. And this is a very rapid migration, we believe, that made it to Australia virtually overnight, within a few thousand years probably of leaving Africa. And we can trace this the migration of these genetic lineages by looking at the DNA of people living on that route today. So people living in southern India, for instance, retain traces of these migrants who went through 50,000 years ago, an extraordinary thing, that these people, in essence, have been living in the same place for 50,000 years and haven't dispersed their genes all over the place. You can still see the palimpsest, a glimpse of this migratory route, which is a good thing, because archaeologically, there's no evidence for it. Not until around 30, 35,000 years ago do we see modern human remains and modern human tools in southern India. And yet, we see modern human remains in Australia at around 50,000 years ago. So clearly, there's a disconnect there. They must have made it through India in order to reach Australia, unless they simply leapt from Africa to Australia, which, of course, is impossible. So the genetics is really giving us the clues about this very early migration along the coast. We believe there was a second migration very soon after this, maybe 45,000 years ago, which went up into the Middle East. And from there, these people actually became the ones who populated most of the Northern Hemisphere, most of Asia, Europe, and ultimately the Americas.
Okay, now that migration that went north, the second migration, I understand then splits. I understand part going into Asia and part going into Europe, but could you elaborate?
Yeah, absolutely. These people are carrying a marker we call M89. It is, you know, a second out of Africa marker. They trace back to, again, a common origin in Africa. But this is a second wave of migration that, as you say, went up into the Middle East. From there, some of them went over into Europe, but not many, we think, because these kind of ancient lineages that would have been found in the Middle East at that time are not found at very high frequency in Europe. Oddly enough, what they chose to do was to migrate into Central Asia. Now, why did they do this? Probably because, as people who were adapted to life on the East African savannas, which is where we believe all of this very early stuff went on, the origin of modern humans and so on, these are grassland dwellers. These people would have wanted to follow the game, the food. And the grasslands lead you into Central Asia out of the Middle East. They don't lead you across Anatolia and into the Balkans. The Balkans are mountainous, forested, etc. And so probably, we believe, they migrated into Central Asia following the herds. And there's very good genetic evidence for this, because the people who lived in Central Asia later migrated westward into Europe, eastward into East Asia, and ultimately into the Americas.
Okay, so we have the second migration with the M89 marker going north, going into now Central Asia, and then at that point splitting in half, more or less, one group then going into Europe, becoming the Europeans, and the other part going into Asia, becoming the Asians.
Yes.
Okay, now where do the Native Americans now come into play?
Well, the Native Americans come out of this Central Asian cauldron, if you will. I mean, this bubbling cauldron of humanity which spewed out people into Europe and into Asia. Some of them migrated north into Siberia, and around 15,000 years ago or so, certainly no earlier than 20,000 years ago based on the genetic dates we have, a few of these people went across the Bering Land Bridge, which existed at that time as a result of the last ice age. The sea levels had dropped, and so there was a land connection between Northeast Asia and the northwestern part of North America. They migrated across into Alaska and ultimately down into North America around 15,000 years ago again.
Okay. Now, as I understand, you can actually trace in Native American peoples not just one wave, but actually several waves of early humans that went through Alaska into the Americas. Is that right?
Yeah, this is the earliest wave of migration, and it's the one that made it very rapidly down into South America, and it is the main wave of migration, we believe, simply because it's these markers, the most common ones we see in Native American populations. But there's good evidence that there was a second migration around 6,000 to 8,000 years ago along the coast, because at that time the Bering Land Bridge had been submerged again, the ice sheets had started to retreat, And so the only way that people could have gotten there is by using boats. And in fact, the distribution of the lineages that probably composed that second wave of migration are found in the western part of North America. They're not found in South America. So it's consistent. The genetic pattern is consistent with what we know about the paleoclimatology, the geology, and so on. So this second migration came across into North America, and the people settled along the coast. And then from there, it migrated somewhat inland.
Now, there's a controversy going on right now concerning Kennewick Man that you're probably familiar with. We have the remnants of a very ancient remains of an individual that seems to predate many of the other Native American fossils that have been found. And this person may not even resemble the other Native Americans, according to facial reconstructions that have been done. But the question is then, who owns these bones? Do Native Americans then, can they bury them as their ancestor? Or do scientists analyze them as nothing but one of several waves that came over from Asia?
Yeah, well, Kennewick is interesting, but actually not anomalous, because all of the skeletons or skulls that I'm aware of, dating from around that time, Kennewick is actually a fairly early remain. It dates from around 9,000 years ago. Most of the remains, the skulls that have been recovered from that time period, the kind of 8 to 11,000 year ago period, look more European than today's Native Americans. And it doesn't matter where they're found. They found skulls in Brazil from that time period that also look a little bit more European. Why is this? Were they, you know, Europeans who had migrated across? No, clearly, again, you look at the genetic lineages, and all Native Americans came out of Asia from Siberia. The reason they look perhaps a little bit more European, again, traces back to this origin in Central Asia. Remember, this is the same group of people who gave rise to the Europeans. So it's probably as a result of the shared ancestry with Europeans long ago on the steppes of Central Asia. So that begs the question, why do today's Native Americans not look like that as well? It's possible that this second wave of migration, which we believe came from further east in Asia, could have brought people who looked a little bit more East Asian or Mongoloid in appearance. And perhaps the mixing of these groups changed the appearance of the Native Americans. It's also possible there were local events that people, you know, over time change anyway. You move into a new area, particularly if the population size is small, and your appearance will change, your gene frequencies will change somewhat due to something we call genetic drift. We don't know exactly, but very clearly, the people living in the Americas today, the Native Americans, trace their ancestry back to this part of Asia, and it's not that there were wandering bands of Europeans here before them.
Okay, now let's talk about the Polynesians. Where do the Polynesians fit into this?
The Polynesians are quite interesting. They ultimately trace back, and I talk about this in my book, The Journey of Man. They ultimately trace back to an origin in Southeast Asia. And they probably, their expansion into the Pacific was driven by the expansion of rice agriculture in East Asia, which increased the population pressure, and people set out on voyages to find new lands to cultivate and so on. And as they migrated southward down into Indonesia and ultimately out into Melanesia around New Guinea, they began to take longer and longer voyages. And some of them, at some point around 5,000 years ago, 4,000 years ago, set off into the Pacific. And you can literally trace the migration of people from island to island with these genetic markers, but they do trace back to this region of Southeast Asia. And we believe, due to the timing, that it probably was ultimately driven by this expansion, the expanding population as a result of the development of rice agriculture.
Okay. Now we also have genetic mysteries that go back centuries. For example, in northern Japan, we have the Ainu people, who are extremely hairy. They're some of the hairiest Caucasians on the planet Earth, from what I understand. They don't look like the native Japanese, who are Asian-looking. And so where did the Ainu of northern Japan come from?
Well, the first point to make is that physical appearance can actually change fairly rapidly. If you take the evidence at face value, everybody living in the world today, share an ancestry in Africa around 50,000 years ago. That's only a couple of thousand generations. That means that within the last couple of thousand generations, we have generated all of the physical diversity we see in the world today. And in fact, even on local levels, you find people changing their appearance today through something we call sexual selection. This was first suggested by Darwin over 100 years ago as the reason why people do look so different. You choose people to mate with on the basis of what you find attractive, and that varies according to where you are in the world. And so, you know, I read a story in the Times of London a couple of years ago about a village in Romania where all of the women have mustaches. because the men in that particular region find it very attractive. And, you know, over time, this may become a defining feature which distinguishes them from people in the surrounding area. So simply because people look different doesn't mean that they have a very different ancestry from the people living nearby. Now, in the case of the Ainu, there are certain markers that are at higher frequency in the Ainu, and they do correlate with probably an earlier expansion into Japan. So perhaps these were the aboriginal inhabitants. Now, it's likely that these people came out of Asia from ultimately the Central Asian stock. So it is consistent, again, with this origin ultimately in Central Asia, the same one that gave rise to the Europeans. So they're retaining, perhaps, European features. Maybe that is part of the reason they do look different from the rest of the Japanese.
Okay, so to sum up, we had the first migration out of Africa that followed the coastline into India and into Australia. We had the second migration that carried the M89 marker that went into Central Asia that then split into many directions, including Europe and China and then the Americas. Were there other migrations out of Africa?
I mean, there has been a certain amount of genetic exchange across the Sahara, but the Sahara is a pretty formidable barrier. There have been back migrations into Africa from the Middle East within the last 10 to 20,000 years. And, of course, there's exchange going on today. And as people, you know, began to sail ships, sort of thinking about the Polynesian expansion, there was actually a migration of Polynesians westward across the Indian Ocean, settling in Madagascar a couple of thousand years ago. And they speak a language which is related to the Polynesian languages, Malagasy, totally unrelated to the African languages spoken nearby. So, you know, there has been some exchange with sub-Saharan Africa, but not much because of, again, that formidable barrier, the Sahara, which has kept populations apart.
And also, what was the mechanism that drove early humans out of Africa? Was it the changing climate? I mean, after all, there was an ice age going on, especially in the northern and southern latitudes. What was the reason why there were all these migrations out of Africa starting around 50, 60,000 years ago?
Well, we do think it comes down to climate change. As you say, we were headed into the worst part of the last ice age, which began roughly 110, 120,000 years ago. But it really started to get bad after around 70,000 years ago. And in fact, we know from looking at other parts of the genome, not the Y chromosome, not mitochondrial DNA, but looking at, you know, the autosomal markers, as we call them, that the population size probably crashed around that time as we were going into the worst part of the last ice age. In fact, some of the most recent results coming out of Mark Feldman's group at Stanford suggest that the population dropped down to a couple of thousand individuals. So we're nearly extinct at that time. We're holding on by our fingernails. What we think happened was the ones who survived, survived because they were very clever. They'd gone through what we call the great leap forward in behavior, when we became behaviorally modern. And that adaptation, if you will, that ability to survive in these harsh conditions also gave them what they needed to be able to go out and take over the world. And so once they survive, once they develop these skills, once they go through what is potentially a genetically caused change in brain structure, once they become smart enough, they can then go out and live in places like Siberia, where, you know, the temperatures dropped to minus 70 in the winter. And they were living there during the last ice age. They had to have been living there in order to make it into the Americas. Absolutely amazing. We are the only species of hominid that's ever been able to live in those conditions. And it's because we are supremely adaptable culturally, because we've evolved this amazing brain that allows us to do that.
Now, according to the history books, Genghis Khan conquered a huge chunk of the surface of the planet Earth, and some people claim to be their descendants. So the question is, was Genghis Khan really the father of Mongolia?
The search for Genghis, yes. This is work that really came secondarily out of, again, this project to try and map the migration through Asia. And I've spent a lot of time over the last decade working and living in Central Asia, taking samples from a lot of unusual populations. Absolutely fascinating part of the world. And one of the things you hear over and over again from people living there is, we must be related to Genghis Khan. He's like a local, you know, historical figure that everyone wants to have some connection with. And so, you know, it's something that's in the back of your mind as you're doing these genetic studies. we weren't really setting out to find his Y chromosome, though. What happened, though, was as a result of doing this analysis on one of the lineages, we noticed a particular set of related Y chromosomes, what we call haplotypes. They're sets of markers that we study. A particular set of related haplotypes that seemed to be at pretty high frequency, and yet they were very, very closely related. And we said, oh, this is kind of weird. You know, what's the distribution? It turns out that the distribution overlaps almost exactly with the distribution of his empire. So we said, well, you know, that's kind of odd. How old is this? You know, if you see something that's that widespread, remember, this is the largest land empire that's ever existed. You know, absolutely amazing. You know, if it's that widespread, it should be pretty old. Well, it turns out that it traces back to an origin around 800 years ago, right around the time that Genghis himself was born.
Well, I'm afraid that's it for Exploration. Once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. And we've been discussing the coronavirus in the first half of the program, taking stock of the last 2 months of lockdown, which has devastated the economy and our lives. And in the second half of Exploration, we brought on Spencer Wells of National Geographic, talking about the genetics, not just of the coronavirus, which has given us the family tree of that deadly virus, but also the genetic family tree of the human race itself. Using genetics, tiny mutations in our genes, to trace the lineage of the human race going back hundreds of thousands, even millions of years into the past. So once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku for Exploration. And if you want a copy of today's program, call the Pacifica Program Service at 1-800-735-0230. 1-800-735-0230 for a copy of today's program. Good day.